Encourage in orthodontics. Do you know, if a ship was going through the sea and the sailor need to stop the ship in the middle, how will they do that? They will throw the anchor in the seabed and this will stop the ship movement. This phenomena of stopping the ship with the help of anchor is known as anchorage. In anchorage in orthodontics is defined as resistance to unwanted tooth movement. For example, in this case, we can see the central incisor is at higher level compared to other teeth. So, when we place an appliance, in this a continuous wire, in order to bring the central incisor in the arch, there will be extrusive force on the central incisor, while the adjacent teeth will have intrusive force following the Newton's third law. Every action has equal and opposite reaction. So here the wanted tooth movement is extrusion of incisor and the unwanted tooth movement is intrusion of the neighboring teeth. So the resistance to this unwanted tooth movement, that is the intrusive forces which are acting on adjacent teeth, the resistance to that is known as anchorage. So adjacent teeth are called as anchor teeth. So from where can we derive this anchorage? The sources of anchorage can be divided into intraoral sources of anchorage and extraoral sources of anchorage. So intraoral sources of anchorage consist of alveolar bone, teeth, basal bone, cortical bone, as well as musculature, while extraoral sources of anchorage are the various facial bones and cranial bones like cervical area, occipital area, parietal area, forehead, as well as chin. The extraoral anchorage is used with the help of the orthopedic appliances. It can be parietal pull headgear, where the force is derived from the parietal bone, cervical pull headgear, where the force is from the cervical area, or occipital, which is the combination of parietal and cervical, and the vector of force is acting through the occipital bone. So now the anchorage can be classified according to manner of force application into simple anchorage, stationary anchorage, and reciprocal anchorage. Let's see them one by one. Here, in this case, for example, we want to retract this canine in the distal direction. So we have to take the support from the molar in this case. Now, when the force is applied to bring the canine distally, but now again during the canine retraction, there is tendency of molar to tip. So the molar teeth here is anchor unit. So the resistance of molar to the tipping in this case while retracting the canines is known as simple anchorage. So the simple anchorage can be defined as the manner and application of force in such a way that it tends to change the axial inclination of teeth that forms the anchorage unit. So in this case, anchorage unit should resist tipping. So we can understand the simple anchorage with another example. Here, this is a removal appliance in which there is a screw is placed to push the palatally placed premolar into the arch. So you can see this tooth is present palatally. Now when the plate is placed and screw is opened, there will be force acting in the buccal direction to push this teeth outwards, and a reciprocal force will be acting on remaining teeth. So the force here, since the appliance is a removal appliance, the force which is applied to other teeth will cause the tipping movement of rest of the teeth. So resistance to the tipping movement by remaining teeth while pushing this premolar in the buccal direction is from example of simple anchorage. Now coming to stationary anchorage. Let's see another scenario. Again, in this case, we want to retract the canine, but here we have placed edgewise appliance. And we all know in edgewise appliance, when the full arch wire is placed, the movement which is achieved is mostly bodily movement. So now in this case, when we are applying the force on the canine through molar, the molar is anchorage teeth, and the movement, counteract movement which will be on the molar will be the bodily movement. Molar will tend to move bodily forward while retracting the canine. So in this type of the movement, the resistance of bodily movement by the anchor teeth is known as stationary anchorage. So the stationary anchorage can be defined as the manner and application of force that tends to displace the anchor unit bodily in the plane of space in which force is being applied. Now, the third type of anchorage is reciprocal anchorage. So, in reciprocal anchorage, two teeth or two set of teeth have equal and opposite movement. So, for example, closure of midline diastema. So, now in this case, we see there is gap between the two central incisors. To close the gap, we have applied a E-chin in between the two central incisors. So now the force which is acting on both the incisors is in opposite direction, and it's trying to bring the incisors towards each other, and closing of the midline diastema will take place. So the resistance offered here by two malposed units when both move in equal to an equal extent in opposite direction. So this is known as reciprocal anchorage. So we can understand reciprocal anchorage by another example. Here in this case, crossbite elastics are given. So what are these crossbite elastics? Here there is the buccolingual discrepancy between the maxillary as well as mandibular molars. The maxillary molars are tilted more buccally, while the mandibular molars are tilted more lingually, because of which there is no occlusion between upper and lower posterior teeth. So in order to achieve the proper occlusion, we place the crossbite elastics from the palatal surface of the maxillary molar to the buccal surface of the mandibular molar. So because when the elastics are placed, there will be the buccal force acting on the maxillary molars, and a lingual force is acting on the mandibular molars, which will bring the upper and lower molar in the proper occlusion. So this type of anchorage is reciprocal anchorage. Another example of reciprocal anchorage is expansion appliance, which is given to correct the constricted arches. So here we can see a coughing spring appliance in which a coughing spring is placed. So when we activate this coughing spring by opening the spring, then it will result in the expansion of maxillary arch. So both the sides of the arches will be moving in equal and opposite direction. So the resistance of this kind of movement is reciprocal anchorage. Now we can classify anchorage according to jaws involved as intramaxillary anchorage as well as intermaxillary anchorage. So what is intramaxillary anchorage? When the anchor units and the teeth to be moved are situated in the same arch. So here there are some examples. In this case, we are retracting the incisors with the help of temporary anchorage device, and both the anchorage and the teeth being moved are in the same arch. So this is example of intramaxillary anchorage. Similarly, the expansion appliance, both the anchor unit as well as the tooth being moved are in the same arch. So this is again intramaxillary anchorage. And here also the force is which we are deriving to distalize the canine is from the molar of the same arch. So this is again example of intramaxillary anchorage, means the anchor unit as well as the teeth to be moved are situated in the same arch. Next is intermaxillary anchorage. The anchor units and teeth to be moved are situated in the opposite arch. Here we can see we are applying a distal force on the upper anteriors, and the force is being derived from the molar of opposite arch. So this is example of intermaxillary anchorage, and this type of elastics are known as class 2 elastics. Now here next example is of the class 3 elastics. Here the retraction force for the lower incisors is being derived from the upper molar. So this type of elastics are called as class 3 elastics, and again these are example of intermaxillary anchorage. So here the molars of both the arches are acting as anchor units. Anchorage can be classified on the basis of number of anchorage units being used as single, compound and reinforced anchorage. So let's see each one of them one by one. So first is single or primary anchorage. It is resistance provided by single tooth, or a single tooth with more alveolar support is used to move one with lesser alveolar support. So in this example we can see the mandibular molar, which has greater bone support, is alone used to bring about the movement of mandibular premolar. So this type of anchorage is called as single anchorage, and it is also called as primary anchorage. So here the mandibular molar is acting as anchor unit. Coming to compound anchorage, more than one tooth in anchorage unit or anchorage is provided by more than one tooth with more support to move a tooth with less support. So here in this case we have seen that the anchorage value is greater for the anchor unit teeth. So how can it be achieved? By having the greater alveolar support. So we can see in this example loop mechanics is being used to retract the upper anteriors, and the force which has been derived to retract these incisors is from the posterior teeth, so which are having the greater alveolar support. So this kind of anchorage is called as compound anchorage. Next is reinforced or multiple anchorage. When more than one type of resistant unit is used, it is called as reinforced or multiple anchorage. So in this case we can see the fixed appliance treatment is going, but we are using headgear also to apply the distal force on the molar to help in the retraction of incisor without movement of the molar in the mesial direction. So this is again external anchorage can be used in form of headgear with the fixed appliance, is an example of reinforced or multiple anchorage. Similarly, in this case, transpalatal arch as well as non-palatal arch is used to resist the mesial movement of the molars while retracting the canines to align the anterior teeth properly. So this is again example of reinforced or multiple anchorage. In cases, we can also bond the second molar and tie both the molars together to increase the root surface area of the anchorage unit, thereby augment the anchorage, and this type of anchorage is also called as multiple or reinforced anchorage. Coming to principles of anchorage. So what are the principles? When one teeth moves, other serves as anchor unit depending on root size, number of root inclination. So coming to each one of them one by one. How root size, if in general that if the root size of the anchor teeth is more than the other teeth being moved, it is known to act as an anchorage. Similarly, teeth having multiple root have more root surface area, therefore they provide better anchorage compared to other teeth. Third is root inclination. For example, in case when we are trying to retract the canine, if the molars root are tilted mesially, so there will be resistance of the movement of the molar to the mesial direction. So here also anchor unit will be augmented. Increase in anchor value by restricting anchor teeth to bodily movement. So we always know that tipping movement can be achieved much easily compared to bodily movement. So in case the anchor teeth is resisted through the bodily movement, then the anchorage value can be augmented. Also, do not use heavy forces which lead to hyalinization. Heavy forces result in the undermining resorption, thereby leading to hyalinization of the around the teeth, thereby resisting the movement of the teeth which is required and causing the undue forces on the anchorage unit. Anchorage planning. Anchorage requirement depends upon number of factors listed as number of teeth being moved. Greater number of teeth being moved, greater is the demand of anchorage. So in this case, we need to augment anchorage. Type of teeth being moved. Movement of anterior teeth provides less strain compared to the multi-rooted teeth. Since the root surface area of the anterior teeth is much less compared to the multi-rooted teeth, so there will be less strain on the anchor unit while retracting the anteriors when compared to the posteriors. Type of tooth movement. Bodily movement applies greater strain on anchorage compared to controlled tipping root movement. For example, if we want to distalize the canine, if we apply a tipping force, controlled tipping force, the strain which will be there on the molar is much less when compared to the retraction of canine through the bodily movement. Duration of treatment. Prolonged duration of treatment places undue strain on the anchorage unit. So we should try to keep the treatment time as less as possible. Last is occlusal interlock. So a good buccal occlusion may always act to resist the undesirable tooth movement of the anchor teeth. So coming to anchorage demand. Anchorage demand can be of three types: maximum anchorage, moderate anchorage, and minimum anchorage. In maximum anchorage, not more than 1/4 of the extraction space should be lost by forward movement of the anchor teeth. So in this case, we have to take care that there is minimum loss of the anchorage. Moderate anchorage, the anchor teeth can be permitted to move forward to 1/4 or half of the extraction space. Coming to minimum anchorage, here more than half extraction space can be lost by moving the anchor teeth mesially in the forward direction. So the maximum demand of anchorage and maximum augmentation reinforcement are needed in the case of the maximum anchorage case, where we do not want that the extraction space is lost by the forward movement of the anchor teeth. Coming to anchorage loss, whenever we do orthodontic treatment, we apply force, and as Newton's third law say, every action has equal and opposite reaction. So certain amount of unwanted movement of the anchor teeth invariably occur during the orthodontic treatment. So anchorage loss can occur in all three planes. Come first is sagittal plane. So example, we want to retract the canines. So in case there is mesial movement of the molar will act as a loss of anchorage. Similarly, proclination of anterior teeth will also act as a anchorage loss in sagittal plane. Vertical plane. In vertical plane, extrusion of molars and bite deepening due to anterior extrusion will act as a anchorage loss in vertical plane. While in transverse plane, buccal flaring due to overexpanded arch form, lingual dumping of lower molars will act as a anchorage loss. So how can we control the anchorage? The anchorage is important because if we lost the anchorage during the teeth movement, there is chances that we cannot achieve the desirable results. For example, a patient comes to us with the proclination of maxillary and mandibular molars. Now we have to retract both upper and lower incisors. So in this case, if there is mesial movement of molars, so the space for distalizing the anterior teeth decreases. So we may not be able to achieve the best results. So in such cases where we do not want the anchorage loss, we have to plan the anchorage properly before starting the treatment. How we are able to, how we can reinforce the anchorage unit, whether we the case is of maximum anchorage, moderate anchorage or minimum anchorage, has to be decided before initiating the treatment after proper treatment planning. So once we have planned the treatment of the patient, now we know that we have to control the anchorage in a certain case. So what all we can do to control the anchorage? First is reinforcement, addition of teeth to the anchorage unit. So if we'll add maximum number of teeth to the anchorage unit, the root surface area of the anchorage unit will increase. Thereby, the resistance of movement will also decrease. Next is reinforcement may also include forces derived from the structures outside the mouth. So, if we want to augment the anchorage, we can also use extraoral appliances in form of cervical pull, occipital or parietal headgear or face mask also. So the external structures of the face will help to augment the anchorage in this case. Subdivision of desired movement. Pit the resistance of a group of teeth against the movement of single teeth. So if we want to get the teeth retraction of all six anteriors, in this case we'll retract the canine separately, then other four teeth will be retracted. So we have divided the teeth and now we are retracting one by one, so there is no undue force on the anchorage unit. Tipping or uprighting. Tip the teeth and then upright them rather than moving them bodily. As told before, tipping movement require less or have less forces on the anchor unit. Cause less forces on the anchor unit. So first we can tip the teeth and then upright them rather than moving them bodily, which will have undue forces on the anchorage unit. Fourth is friction and anchorage control strategies. One step space closure with frictionless appliance can help in that. Two step space closure by sliding the canine along the arch wire, then retracting the incisors will reduce the friction as well as force required to retract the teeth. Two-step closure by tipping the anterior segment with some friction and then uprighting the tip teeth will again help to maintain the anchorage in that area. Next, last is skeletal anchorage. Skeletal anchorage in form of implants and mini implants derived the force from the basal bone, cortical bone, etc. Nowadays, temporary anchorage devices are gaining a lot of popularity because the forces are derived from outside the arch. So there is no undue movement of the teeth. So the space which has been used to retract is maximum, and we can achieve the best results, best facial aesthetics with the help of temporary anchorage devices. Usually temporary anchorage up devices are placed in between the root structures, and they are gaining popularity nowadays. Different areas can be chosen for different kind of the movement through temporary anchorage devices. So this is the all about the anchorage. So basically we have to remember in this to conclude that every action has equal and opposite reaction. So whenever we are doing any tooth movement, we should analyze and think what all other forces are acting on the anchor tooth. So how can we augment the anchorage? How can we avoid the unwanted tooth movement which is not required to achieve the best aesthetics for the patient? The happy patient will make you more happy. So I hope the topic was cleared. Thank you so much for listening patiently.